This week on WealthTrack, value investing is out of style, but veteran small cap value manager Charlie Dreifus is sticking with his contrarian risk-averse approach. He is next on Consuelo Mack WealthTrack.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Thornburg Investment Management, Active Management, Flexible Perspective. Ku and Patricia Ewan through the Ewan Foundation, committed to bridging cultural differences. And the Fairholm Foundation.
Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. Are you a value or a growth investor? Do you favor cheap stocks or are you willing to pay up for above average growth in earnings or revenues? Do you look for companies that are overlooked or out of favor and in some cases even shunned because of real or perceived problems? Or do you prefer to buy stocks on the rise with upward momentum? Those are some of the most basic differences between value and growth stocks. Now, historically, over the decades, value stocks have outperformed growth, although there have been times when growth became widely popular, such as the Nifty 50 era of the 60s and 70s, when then fast-growing large-cap stocks like Coca-Cola, General Electric, IBM, and McDonald's dominated the new high list. And of course, there was the 90s tech boom, when fast-moving dot-com revenues were all the rage. Since the great financial crisis, we have been in another extended period where growth has outperformed value, and in recent months, the gap between the price earnings multiples of value and growth stocks has been widening, not narrowing. The behavior of small company stocks is a case in point. As of the end of 2017, the small cap benchmark Russell 2000 Growth Index had outperformed Russell 2000 Value in 7 of the last 9 calendar years. That is a huge change from the past. Over the last 40 years since the Russell 2000 Index's creation, value's 12,000% gain or 13% annualized returns have swamped growth's 4,000% rise or 10% annualized returns. Well, why is value so undervalued these days? Joining us is one of the top value managers in the business. He is Charlie Dreifus, longtime lead portfolio manager of the Roy Special Equity Fund, which he has managed since the fund's inception 20 years ago. The fund is rated 4-star by Morningstar and carries a silver medalist analyst rating for its consistent execution and attractive risk-reward profile. Even with nearly 10% annualized returns, special equity has lagged its benchmark over the last bull market decade, but it has beaten the market since inception. I asked Dreifus to explain why value has not been as highly valued as growth.
Well, there are at least two reasons. The first reason is that post-Great Financial Crisis, despite the efforts of the central banks to flood the system with liquidity, there was minimal growth. We didn't have economic growth anywhere, including the United States.
Right.
So the liquidity ended up in financial assets, lifting prices and bringing yields even further down. But the economy was not strong enough that companies exhibited growth. So those fewer companies that had a growth story were sought after because that was something that you would pay up for because of the scarcity value. The other thing that works with growth stocks is that they are generally, one way of valuing them is discounting the present value of future earnings. And the future earnings are discounted at a discount rate, which has to do with the interest rate. And interest rates being low, that adds to the value of the growth stocks as well. But the primary reason was the absence of growth in the economy and people desiring to own growth. The other thing, which is much more subtle, which very few people have picked up on, but I have actually, because of my mentor, Abe Briloff, I'm trying to do something that I think he would be doing these days. The proliferation of non-GAAP which has really occurred more in the growth segment technology.
Generally accepted accounting
principles. Yeah, so non-GAAP is using not generally accepted accounting principles. We dub it earnings before bad stuff. So what you do is you add back to earnings things like stock compensation or amortization of intangibles that you that are the result of you buying a business.
Mm-hmm.
So you're not accountable for any of these things. And those items are much more prevalent in growing companies. And what it does, it embellishes the numbers. It makes the numbers bigger and makes the valuations seem less excessive.
The value companies, and explain what you mean at Royal Special Equity by value. I mean, you're categorized by Morningstar and others, and you know, Royce is a value shop, and so. But what does value mean?
It's buying a company, and there are different. Even within Royce, there are different colors.
But for you, what does value mean?
Value to me is buying a company at a price such that if I bought the entire company, the earnings that I will receive, and I have to make a judgment as to the sustainability of those earnings.
Right.
They don't necessarily have to improve. In special equity, there are a lot of prosaic companies. They're not particularly fast growers.
Mm-hmm.
But the essence is you have to have confidence as to the stability of that level of earnings. But at that level of earnings, if I borrowed the entire amount to buy that company, the cost, the interest cost on the borrowings would be substantially below what I would receive.
Mm-hmm.
So it's an entrepreneurial, it's a business way. I dub it absolute value.
Mm-hmm.
Absolute value is different than relative value. Relative value says this stock is cheap compared to the market.
Right.
But the market may be very expensive, so it's a false inexpensiveness. So it's interesting, there have been, in the Royce special equity history, there have been 19 calendar years of results. In those 19 calendar years, there were 6 years where the Russell index, Russell 2000 index.
Right, which is your benchmark,
declined.
For small cap,
Right. In one of them, we went down, 2008, much less in the market, but we went down.
Mm-hmm.
And there was 1 year where we went down more than the index, and that was 2015, which I, perhaps rationalizing it, but I legitimately, looking at it clinically, I do believe this was the reason. It was 2015 was the FANG market.
Mm-hmm, right.
And the FANG market was also in small caps. Having lived through the Nifty 50 of 1970, the anointed 50 stocks, we had many fewer in 2015.
Right.
And if you didn't have those stocks,
you were going to underperform.
Right. So I actually, that's the only year in my career that I've actually gone down more than the index. But it speaks, I think the causation, going to your question about value, is how we parse value. It's the desire to buy absolute value,
mm-hmm.
and then doing what people have suggested is sort of my claim to fame, is the deep dive into the accounting. And so that's belts and suspenders.
Mm-hmm.
Again, very risk adverse.
Mm-hmm.
I view myself as a risk manager.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a performance pattern that clearly underperforms the upside.
Right.
Over the 20-year history, we have an upside-downside capture ratio of 73% on the upside.
Mm-hmm. You capture 73% of the market's
rise. But we only sustain 50% of the market's decline.
5-0.
5-0. So the mathematics of that are great because mm-hmm. if you lose less, you have more corpus still at work.
Right.
And so it's particularly important for people who are retired or endowments where they're taking money out
mm-hmm.
that you know you have a spend rate or assumed rate of withdrawal. If you do that and the assets have been depleted, it takes away from the future gains that you can enjoy.
In your 50-year experience of managing money, has there been a period like this where you know, just where kind of the intrinsic value, the numbers, you deep dive into the accounting, you know what a company is worth, that it doesn't matter. I mean, for an extended period of time like this, where, because underperformance does matter, versus a benchmark, even though you're making 9% annualized returns, which is a really good return, you know, compared to whatever the market's doing, if it's less, people look at that and just say, no, this is not good enough. Or,
well, no, that's a fair point. And you know, I take my responsibilities seriously. So underperforming is not fun.
No.
The time that's most reminiscent of sort of the, obviously, the Nifty 50 in 73, 74 was like this, but in recent times, probably the most reminiscent was the tech bubble.
Yeah.
When not only were these value stocks ignored, they were sold.
Yes.
To buy.
Absolutely, because people were chasing performance.
Right, right. And then we've gotten further. Another something that is different is the fact that we have so much momentum investing, some of which is strictly passive investing.
Mm-hmm.
So as things go up, they're waiting in the indices,
increases,
and that it's self-fulfilling until it isn't.
Mm-hmm.
So people have dubbed my approach as discipline, contrarian. Yeah, I like buying the straw hats in the winter when no one else is buying them. There are more bargains. What you have to do, the onus on me, is to make sure that I'm not buying something that's dying.
Right. So let me to that point. So, for instance, you have some brick and mortar retailers.
Yep.
Yes. And you and I talked privately about the fact that Wayfair is an online retailer. They've got cheap, kind of trendy things. And it's the stock's done incredibly well.
The Wayfair is a classic example of a growth stock where you're paying for futures. You're paying for the notion, which is still unproven, that they can ultimately make some money. They have negative earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization.
Sounds familiar.
Okay. So, this goes back to the tech bubble kind of.
It does.
Yeah, right.
It does.
So they don't make any money no matter how you want to calculate it. The notion is, though, that they're growing so rapidly.
Yes.
And the customers, they have a very high acquisition cost. But if those
acquisition of customers.
Right. So if they can retain those customers, and those customers don't just order when they move into a new apartment, but they sustain their purchases rather than having to go out of a new set of those new customers.
Right.
That ultimately, as Amazon has shown, can provide a basis for
earnings.
So it may work, but it's buying futures. There was a great white paper, and I'm dating myself here. It was issued roughly 1975 by Kidder Peabody of blessed memory.
Yes.
That spoke to torpedo stocks, companies with high expectations that don't meet it. And sometimes not meeting it doesn't mean you're not growing, but growing at a lesser rate.
Right, absolutely.
And the stock gets clobbered.
Mm-hmm.
There are people who are very skilled at buying those stocks. I'm not one of them.
Mm-hmm.
It's not in my DNA.
Right.
And let me make the point as I'm speaking about it, because your view is, these days, earnings per share are even less reliable.
Or reflective of what's really going on financially.
Because of at least two major factors.
Mm-hmm.
One is the tax cuts. So companies showing higher earnings, their operating income, which is earnings before interest and taxes, can actually
be
down.
Uh-huh.
But because much lower taxes, their income is higher.
I see. And so it's a tax-based
gain. And furthermore, since 2007, actually, this year we will exceed the share buybacks, the highest share buybacks prior to 2018 were 2007.
Wow, right.
Okay, right before the crash.
Before the GFC, the crash.
And we're on that, we're running at a rate much in excess of 2007.
And of course that boosts the earnings per share.
Share, and that's been going on entirely, and this repatriation that's occurring is being used to fuel some of that. So you have lower taxes and fewer shares as the denominator.
So it looks like corporate earnings are great.
Yeah, right? and they are improving.
And they are improving.
But they're getting a turbocharge.
You told me that in the special equity, it's a very concentrated portfolio. The top 10 positions are 40% of the value, and that you fish in a very limited pond. So describe the pond that you are fishing in special equity.
Okay. So,
and is it getting more limited?
Yes, as the market rises, by definition, because what I'm looking for, the first variable, and what Steve and I do, we screen for candidates, and then we start doing all of that other work.
Right.
So there are certain metrics that are helpful for screening what we're potentially interested in. The first one has to do with that cap rate.
Mm-hmm.
I need a rate. If the junk bond is 6.5%, which frankly is too low, it should be higher these days, it's still benefiting from the suppression of interest rates.
Mm-hmm.
So I need something 9.5 or 10 to exceed the cost of capital.
Right, so, and the cost of capital, and again, these are smaller companies, so therefore they're in the junk bond. If they're,
they wouldn't be investment grade.
They're not investment grade.
That's one thing we can screen for. The next, and that's a classic sort of margin of safety notion, which it wasn't one that Ben Graham used himself, but the notion of margin of safety, which is to tilt the odds in your favor.
Mm-hmm.
I've used this absolute valuation metric as my tool for that. The second tool we use, which is out of Warren Buffett's toolbox, is return on invested capital.
Mm-hmm.
Return on invested capital tries to find, in Buffett's terminology, those moats, those franchises, those niches that he so wishes to acquire.
Right.
So a company with a high return on invested capital, it suggests that they have some pricing power. They don't necessarily have a lot of competition. So that is a decent but not infallible proxy for trying to find moats. And then we have other metrics, amount of leverage. My companies have very little leverage. Amount of cash they have per share. Amount of net networking capital, which again is a Ben Grahamism, which is sort of a liquidator's approach to looking at a stock.
And Cooper Tire, I mean, these are, you know, Cooper Tire, Winnebago, those are two companies that you own. How do they exemplify your Roy special equity approach?
Well, they meet the mathematical...
The accounting criteria, right.
Cooper Tire is exceptionally inexpensive. Cooper Tire, a recent analyst study showed that their facilities here in the United States are valued in the marketplace right now at a half to a third of what a grassroots, meaning if you set up a new tire plant, it would cost you either double or triple what this company is selling at. So it is a value, it is inexpensive. They sell replacement tires. Now,
is that a business that you want to be in? Again,
yes and no.
Businesses are so prosaic,
right?
But why do you want to own them?
Well, replacement tires obviously are less, theoretically, less cyclical than original equipment tires.
Because
what we're finding is, and some of it, it's interesting, it's technology again, tire life has expanded because of the sensors.
Mm-hmm.
The sensors alert you when you have low tire pressure.
Yes.
So if you fill it, the tire will last longer. So there are headwinds. Wherever you look, there are headwinds. That's the job of the portfolio manager, right, to weigh those. So what Cooper Tire is inexpensive, great balance sheet. The concept here, this industry traditionally had a lot of price cutting, very tough competition. There are signs that they learned their lesson. And they are promotional to give you, if you buy a set of four new tires, you'll get a $100 gift card or something like that. But they're not slashing tire prices. And that speaks to sort of a statesmanship, mm-hmm, that hopefully is unfolding. It's a work in process.
Okay.
But the stock is so cheap that I don't believe I'm taking a lot of risk participating in that. Winnebago is a classic name in
absolutely
the RV business. What has happened, and again speaks to the younger crowd, there's a towable RV. Rather than these big sort of buses,
yes,
it's something that you hook up to your car. It's sort of what they had back in the 1940s,
sure,
but
the
much
campers.
Smaller.
Right.
Much smaller. So this is entry level. You can start at $30,000, $40,000, and this gets people into that outdoors life, mm-hmm, which so many young people
absolutely
wish to do. And they're doing quite well in the towables. The interesting thing is their traditional motorhomes, the Winnebagos, have been doing less well.
Yeah, I remember reading about that. Right.
So, and that was an issue of their some self-inflicted items, and also the industry trending towards less expensive, even motorhomes, but then also headed to the towable area. So again, a stock, Winnebago is quite volatile.
One investment for a long-term diversified portfolio, what would you have all of us own some of?
I think people at this stage of the market should be de-risking. But certainly one way, and that's going to be my answer, is a balanced fund,
mm-hmm,
a fund that has equities but
bonds,
high quality bonds, investment right grade bonds. So
because you're going to need that type of balance.
Yeah, if the one I have in mind, the current yield on it is about 3.3%.
Mm-hmm.
And frankly, that may be what the market return is over the next
right. So which fund is it?
So it's the Vanguard Wellesley Income Fund.
Oh, that's an old fund.
It's an old fund.
It's been around a long time, right?
Been around a long time. It's been tested. They have about 36, 37% in equities.
Mm-hmm.
What they do, which to their credit, it's higher yielding equities, but it's also something that I favor and look for, dividend aristocrats, companies that raise
sure
their dividends.
Mm-hmm.
Then the 62-3% is in investment grade bonds, and then they have about 1% in cash.
Wow, that's conservative.
It's conservative.
Right.
But because most balanced funds are 60% equity,
yes,
40%
yes
bonds. This turned it around.
Right.
So I think, and again, it depends on one's risk tolerance,
right,
one's age, but this is a time to think about those things, even if you don't act on it. But I think that should be a part of every person's portfolio.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, yes, it's not without its risks, but I think it's substantially less than being in the market, and particularly in a passive. These days are not the days for passive investing.
Mm-hmm.
Because
for passive index funds.
Yeah, because when the market correction comes, the most heavily weighted securities
right
are going to suffer the most.
And those are the kind of high-flying growth names, and they're
right
going to get possibly clobbered, yeah. Charlie Dreifus, such a treat to have you on. Thank you so much for being on WealthTrack.
My pleasure, and congratulations on 15 years of WealthTrack.
Thank you so much. We're thrilled to be here, too. Thanks, Charlie.
Thank you.
At the close of every WealthTrack, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point follows Charlie Dreyfus's suggestion, which is to de-risk at least a portion of your portfolio. If you are well diversified among stocks, bonds, and cash, you have already started. However, a review of what kinds of stocks and bonds might be in order. Faster growing but lesser quality stocks are usually more vulnerable in a market correction than financially strong, more sustainable businesses. And among bonds, any issues rated less than investment grade can be just as volatile as stocks. As Dreifus said, de-risking can hurt performance in a bull market, but it cushions losses in bear markets, which protects principal and gives you more money to work with over the years. Well, next week, what do top-performing investors and recognized financial thought leaders think about Bitcoin? Join us to find out. In the meantime, on this week's extra feature, Dreifus shares his mentor's mission of bringing principals back to accounting. We always welcome your feedback. Please continue to reach out to us on Facebook and Twitter. Thank you for watching. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Thornburg Investment Management, active management, flexible perspective. Koo and Patricia Ewan through the Ewan Foundation, committed to bridging cultural differences. And the Fairholme Foundation.